Good day, folks. This is Greg Judy at Green Pastures Farm. Welcome. It's a beautiful day here. It's the second day of August, and just wishing everybody a good weekend, and we're enjoying it. We've got some rain. Typically, we don't get a lot of rain in July and August, but the last week has been an exception. We're very thankful for that. We've been catching, like half inch here, half inch there, inch here, and it's just normally doesn't happen. Not this early when it's this hot. But it's cooled off. I mean, we're in the 70s today, 80s, and so Missouri can be anywhere from 100 degrees all the way down to, I think, Tuesday night they're calling for 57 degrees here in the evening. So it's very flexible back and forth. Anyway, the topic today, I want to talk a little bit about litter, ground litter, and what it does for our farm. Everybody talks about, they get freaked out. They'll come out here and they're like, Greg, why are you moving the animals? You laid all this stuff on the ground. Why don't you make them eat that? So they trampled a lot of this green forage on the ground. Instead of making them eat it, I moved them. I just took them out of here. And this is Judy Farm here. It's a little bottom that runs up through here that my dad used to plant every year into corn. Soybeans, and he would plow this every spring, every single spring. He mow-bore plowed it, and I can remember seeing the sheet erosion on here. A lot of it ended up in what we call Coon Creek over here. I've never plowed it since I bought it. We've got it put into grass, but I wanted to show you here, if you look real close here at the ground, you can see what the cows trampled on the ground. All this dead matter, this was the green. That was all green when the cows were in here grazing, and they did this. They laid it on the ground surface. And they laid it on the ground surface, they broke the line of sap that was feeding that plant. They bent the stem over, and that stopped that sap flow going back to the roots. So now you got all this carbon laying on the land. And look what's coming up through it. People, it's not waste. Get that out of your brain. It's not waste. You're feeding the soil. And all the rain we've had in the last week, that creek's not flowing hardly at all. It's all being caught out here on the landscape because we have this beautiful, beautiful organic sponge out here protecting our top of our property, catching the rain, percolating down through here, and it's feeding all the soil microbes. The earthworms and the grasses get to use all this for the roots, and it just comes floating back up. So it's a cycle that's been happening for thousands of years. Ruminant animals crossing along the landscape, trampling golden litter on the ground and leaving. This has got 3 weeks rest on it. So we're not going to be back here for another 5 weeks. Okay. So this is going to be probably about here. In another 5 weeks, the cows will come through and we're gonna repeat the process. They'll trample all of this on the ground, it's gonna feed the soil, and it's regenerative. It's regenerative ranching, that's what we're doing. And that's why we're so excited about healing the landscape with just this ruminant animal. And it's just, to me, I guess I can't say enough about, don't call it waste. You're feeding the soil microbes. Folks, there's more animals under our feet on healthy soil, in the soil, than there is above the soil. So you got to feed them. You got to feed them something.
Well, and something else you mentioned, Greg, we're having 70s and 50s. That's optimal growing. We've got something left there.
It absolutely is. I mean, for cool season grasses especially, you start getting down the 70s and, 50s and 60s at night, you're going to get this explosion of cool season grasses. And that's what we're seeing. But the reason we're seeing this explosion of legumes and grasses coming up out of here, it's going to be exciting to see what's going to happen in the next 2 to 3 weeks.
And we just got through having 100-degree temperatures. So what did that litter do?
Well, the 100-degree temperatures insulates the ground. And so I can pull this litter back on a really hot day and lay my hand on the ground surface. And it's cool. It's like 75, 80 degrees on there where air temperature is 100, okay? If you can keep your soil temperature cool, your soil microbes will continue to work for you. 90% of all soil life resides in the top 3 inches of your soil. So that's why you need this. You've got to keep this carbon laid across your land with ruminant animals to keep that soil surface cool.
So like people who don't move their cattle and they just let them eat it down, so...
Yeah, you know, I get that all the time. People say, well, I rotate my cattle. They rotate themselves, and I'm not messing with that electric fence, you know, stressing them. It's no stress. It's no stress on them at all. They learn to respect it, and they get a fresh sound bar every single day, twice a day. If you just let the cattle rotate themselves, you're not going to have anything but bare ground. And that's because the animals will go in, and they'll graze. They'll graze the best plants off first. And they'll keep eating those plants until they get them clear down to the ground. And then your whole farm is covered with a bunch of...
We don't even have anything.
We don't have any. I'm sorry. I call it undesirables. There is no undesirables out here. I had a guy comment this morning. Said, well, great, you know, that tall stuff, you let it get tall, you got all those weeds, and you got more weed seed. There's been weeds for however old you think the earth is. There's been weeds that long. There's tons of weed seeds down here. Don't worry about it. You got to have some weeds. You're going to always have some weeds. Don't go out and stay focused on weeds, because that's what you'll have. Cattle will make your whole farm weeds if you don't move them. Because they're going to leave all those. They're not going to eat them. But if you put cattle in tight and tighter, increase your stocking density and move them more frequently, they eat a lot of these weeds, or they'll trample them on the ground. I don't care if the cow doesn't eat them, but I want her to trample them. If she can get that trampled on the ground, what's that? It's carbon. We're feeding the soil.
Keeping it cool.
There's never been a weed grown that eventually doesn't end up in the belly of an earthworm.
And we're keeping the ground cool.
Keeping the ground cool, absolutely.
Or in the wintertime, we're keeping it warm.
Keeping it warm. So in the wintertime, if you can keep your soil warmer going into fall, what that does for you, having this on there, on your surface, it keeps that soil warmer and your plants will grow longer into the fall. So here, to give you an example, in Missouri, our killing frost is October 10th. Folks, if you can keep a good litter bank out there on your land, and that, heck, the plants don't know it, it's warm down in there. They'll continue to keep growing green. We've had stuff grow clear up into the second week of December here in Missouri, and we get cold out there. So protect the surface, feed the soil some litter, and it does so many things for you. And it's going to grow you more feed. At the end of the day, that's what we are, folks. The ruminant animals are a tool, okay? They're harvesting this for us. But at the end of the day, we are soil microbe farmers. I used to think of myself as a grass farmer. And Ian from Africa, he corrected me. He said, Greg, you're not a grass farmer. I'm like, yeah, I am. That's what we do. He goes, no. It starts below the grass. It's down in the soil. So if you think of yourself as a soil microbe farmer, that's what this is. I'm feeding my soil microbes. You're going to have grass. You're going to have clover. You're going to have bird's foot tree fall. You're going to have all these different species of forages out there, complements of you feeding your soil.
So something too, carbon, what's, you're saying like we're not getting that much water going into the creek.
Yeah. I mean, I wish I had an example here, but I could take a 5-gallon bucket and pour it right here on the ground. This has got a little slope to it. It's not going to go anywhere. It can't, because it's got all this stuff. It's got all this dead stuff that the cows are trampling. Now, some of that's still got a little green in it. It hasn't turned brown yet. Of course, I pulled it. I didn't get a clean pick on it. I mean, there's a ton of dry matter here. And so it absolutely is. It's holding on to that rain. It's not letting it leave your farm. I like to tell people, I don't want to share my rain. I don't want to share it. What falls on our farm, I want to keep it. I'm not giving it to my neighbor. He can do what we do, and he can save his own rain. Don't be giving your water to your neighbor. And if you continuously graze around your farm and don't rotate, that's what you're doing.
Yeah, I'm going to just shoot up here and show you that we do have a slope up here that comes down to this bottom. You can kind of tell there's a little bit of slope, but we're capturing the rain.
Yeah, and you can tell by the ground. I mean, it's just exploding with new growth. I've been on farms that were continuously grazed, and the first thing you'll see, folks, on a continuously grazed farm is the plants are growing along the surface of the ground. They're just trying to survive. And so you'll see a lot of wild white clover. Wild white clover thrives under continuous grazing. It can grow real short to the ground. It sends out rhizomes, and animals can eat that, and it'll send out more. And another plant species you'll see a ton of is bluegrass. So if you go into a farm, you're looking at buying, or maybe you're just looking at your management on your own farm, if you see just tons of bluegrass and white clover, that's all you see, is those two species, you're probably overgrazing. You're probably coming back too soon. You need to get this thatch out here. You need to have some diversity. And with that, I'm going to walk over here to the savanna area. I'm going to show you what we've got going on over here. Look at the forage we have in here. Now this hasn't been grazed. We skipped this the last two rotations.
And why did we do that?
This is the riparian zone. There's a creek in here. That's Coon Creek.
And you kind of see the sandbar over there.
Yeah, there's a sandbar over there. The dogs like playing in. Anyway, we normally graze this, but we had a cow that went up in that timber. There's 40 acres of white oak timber up in there. And she went up there and calved this spring. We didn't know it. We left her behind. Long story short, it was 4 or 5 days before we got her out of there. She hit her calf up in there. We finally got her out. She came out with a calf, and the boys and I spent, a lot of time messing with that. I'm like, you know what? We're just going to run a wire along that creek and not let them up in there. Well, now we're pretty much done calving. A few stragglers coming up, but not very many. We're going to let them in here. We'll be back here in 5 weeks, okay? And they're absolutely going to go through there. I mean, you talk about some forage. Folks, I've seen cows doing that, having it hang down in their mouth. And I've seen other cows come up behind them and yank it out. Yank it out of their mouth. It's really high quality forage, field bindweed. Crop farmers hate this stuff, but us grazers, look at that. It's just solid. We didn't plant it. Again, it's a lagoon. It's got leguminous features to it. It's just a wonderful vine, but it will cover everything in here. It has. But boy, when the cows hit this, I'm going to do a video of it. It's going to be something. I mean, they are just going to go heyday in here. And this is where Jan takes her walks at with her dogs. She can't even walk through here anymore. It's that thick. I mean, it's up. You see how tall it gets. Yes, it's up to my waist. And anything it can find to grow on, all you can see is growing on that post right there. It'll grow on trees. It'll get tall. It'll go up trees like that. Here's one that's, 5 feet tall. Now, some people look at that as a weed. That field bindweed. We look at it as forage. That's forage. Look at that. Don't tell cows that that's a weed. Doesn't matter. They're still going to eat it. So we're excited to have it in here.
And a lot of natural lagoons, what are they adding to the soil?
So you're getting free nitrogen. Legumes have the unique ability to fixate nitrogen from the atmosphere around them. And they bring it down and they deposit it into nodules. And these little nodules are living on the root hairs. When you pull up a red clover plant, don't pull it up, dig it up. If you start looking on the roots, you'll see all these little bumps down there. And if you take your pocket knife and cut them open, you can see the insides of them. That's where they're storing the nitrogen at. And the grasses come along and they'll actually use some of that nitrogen, steal it.
And how do they do that? They do that with the microbes.
Absolutely. It takes the microbes to make all this stuff work. Back to, we're soil microbe farmers. So I'm kind of getting wrapped up on that, but Jan wanted me to talk a little bit about these. These are all my two books that I wrote. The first one is called No Risk Ranching. That was written in 2002. Talks about our progress that we started. I was broke. I was doing everything conventional, and I started doing things unconventional. In other words, whatever my neighbors were doing, I did the opposite of. And that's when things started to turn around. You can't expect to do the same thing every year and expect a better result. That's the definition of insanity, okay? So no risk ranching, custom grazing on leased land. It goes through all what we started with, running other people's livestock on other people's leased land. So we were basically in the landscape management business. We also a caretaker of other people's cows. And we got paid so much a day per cow to do that, or stalkers.
And that's how we got out of debt.
That's how we got out of debt, absolutely. Jan and I met in 1997. I was in the middle of divorce. I could see the farm was pretty much history. I was going to lose it. And I read an article that said your sole purpose in life should not be to own the land, but to control it. And I'm like, wait a minute, that's the key. And so Jan and I started putting together these leases, and she would come over and help me. And we developed these leases, and today we've got 16 farms. We now own 4 of those, we're out of debt, and we haven't looked back. 2008, I came out with this one, Comeback Farms. This basically takes off from where No Risk Ranching left off, doing a lot of the different grazing practices. This is about the time I met, a couple years before this, I met Ian Mitchell Ennis from South Africa, started doing more of the holistic management, plan grazing type, mob grazing management. Hair sheep were brought into the farm operation, guard dogs, just a whole host of neat things that new things that we're doing that we weren't doing in this book. But starting out, I'm telling you folks, this one will get you going. It's got contracts in there, how we write up our lease contracts, the custom grazing contracts, what we focused on first. So both of them are good books. And then
and we're hoping this by the end of the year to have another book out.
Yes, a matter of fact, I've got the third book done. We're just waiting on getting it all edited, and we'll probably have that hopefully published by the end of the year, and maybe even we're looking at maybe doing a Kindle book on that. So this is our t-shirts, Green Pastures Farm, and on the back it says, there's clover all over Green Pastures Farm, and winter grass will save your ass. And that's the truth. Winter stockpiling, folks, that's where it's at.
And when does that start?
Started yesterday, August 1st.
It started August a month 1st. Ago.
Yeah, I mean, official definition kickoff of winter stockpiling is August 1st. But if you wait till August 1st to start doing it, it's your management throughout the whole growing season that sets up your winter stockpile, and that's what people are missing. If you go out in the spring and you nuke your farm by grazing it off too short early in the spring, that affects your winter stockpile that fall. Believe it or not, it does. And that's some of the things we covered in our grazing schools, and those are coming up in September. They're both sold out, but we plan on doing one in May of next year, in 2021. Get my ears straight.
We might do two. It depends on how it goes.
Yeah. Anyway, check out our website, greenpasturesfarm.net. Got the new hats out. Check those out. We've got red. Help me out, Jan. Red.
Green. And dark gray. They haven't got the light grays made yet.
Check out the hat. Good looking hats. Those will be on our website as well. So, anyway, I just want to give a plug for that. And everyone have a great day. Keep your chins up. Stay safe out there. We'll see you all down the road.
Hit the like button.
Oh, yes. New subscribers, hit that subscribe button. I'm sorry, new viewers, hit the subscribe button and the like button on the way out. Thank you all.